Welcome everyone, I'm Janet Skinner. I'm an artist and author, and I've created some wonderful works which I'm going to share with you today. In total, I've completed more than 30 paintings of the Medway towns. The film is called Walking Through Medway. As a child, I walked for hours and hours and had such fun in those days with my brother and sister, Lynn and Tony. We would walk from Wainscot to Chatham sometimes, but often to Rochester. And then we would walk from Wainscot through Frinsbury, across towards Whitewall Creek, down to where there's now a big tunnel, which we called the Rats, because there were so many rats and wildlife there. And then we would walk on past the Sandy Cliffs, on towards Upnor. And all these paintings are my memories of how I remember them. I've used some sketches that I did when I was at art college. I went to the Medway College of Design. I started there in 1970. By the way, if you can hear birds and everything in the background, you're right, you can hear birds. It's impossible to get anything totally silent. And the banging in the roof is actually possums. So, anyway, we'll do our best. So the film you're going to see today is broken into three parts. There's walking to Rochester via Frinsbury and Strood. That's the first little film. Then the second one is walking to Upnor via Frinsbury and Whitewall Creek. And the third one is walking to Wainscot Village and Wainscot School. And also I talk about the fire that happened in the 1980s. So the main body of work are paintings between 1957 and 1970. And there's one or two at the end of Gillingham and other areas of Medway that were done around about the 80s. So the first of the three walks you're going to see today is walking from Wainscot to Rochester by Strood. We have some delicious things to talk about, like the Rochester markets and the Odeon and Lane's the toy shop. Well, here we go then. Thank you.
Walking to Rochester via Frinsbury and Strood. Rochester is in the Medway Towns, which is southeast of England, very close to London for people that don't know. So we start our journey by leaving my home on the Wainscot Estate, passing by the nearby phone box on the Frittenden Road, past the Sandsprell pub, and onwards towards the farm shop on Frinsbury Hill. This painting is set in the late 1950s. I hated going past the shop because the chickens would chase me all the way up Frinsbury Hill. This painting is done using acrylic paints. I'm the little girl on the right. That's just the detail of the farm shop. And this is a map of where it would have been. Like, this is a map of today, and that's the position. On we would walk towards Bingham Road. Bingham Road post office. I hated going there. My mum would talk and talk, and it would drive me totally mad. Sometimes the weather was awful too. This painting took about 3 days to complete, and I've used acrylic paints. This is an image of my family. Now we would head on further, heading towards Strood and North Street. We'd been walking for about a mile by now. I didn't like North Street at all. To me as a child, it was a creepy place. The houses all had witches in them and goblins, and yeah, I was really quite frightened. This is a present day photo of North Street. On we would walk to the Strood Fair. We didn't ever go there very often. It was very expensive. The fair has been on that site for centuries in the very same place. And the bit of land is just preserved for the fair. Nothing I know of goes on there other than the fair. The Strood Locks were a very scary place to visit. The gates upon which we walked were rotting and wobbly. Goodness knows why we went there. The locks have since been filled in, and houses have been built on the adjacent land. Rochester Bridge. A bridge has been on this site for centuries. Strood stands on one bank and Rochester on the other. Beneath the bridge were several sets of stairs. One set was horrendously precarious, slippery, very rickety and terrifying. The other set was doable. I have absolutely no idea how we got permission to go down these sets of stairs. And I don't think anybody ever did. This is a view from Rochester Bridge. Here we can be seen making our way over the bridge, and the view is Rochester Castle in view. I am the one in the middle. My brother is to the left and my sister to the right. We took our satchels with us everywhere we went. We had our swimming costumes in there. Now we're on to Rochester Markets. The markets always was a boring place to go, so tiring as a child. However, the railway line perched high on the embankment past the markets. We were there the day the last steam train traversed the track. I remember everyone cheering. People were so glad to see the dirty steam trains gone forever. The green electric trains had come into fashion. The bee's knees in those days. The Odeon Cinema was situated near the bottom of Star Hill on the lower Rochester High Street. It was a hive of activity, both as a cinema and for shows. There were two queues, one for the stalls and the other for the circle. In 1969, while I was at the Medway College of Art, I worked at the cinema on weekends as an usherette, for 2 years in fact. It was fun those days, hard work, but great. I do remember the crowds, all standing in the weather, in the bad rain and the wind. In 1963, we had a particularly harsh winter. There was lots of snow everywhere and we were cooped up for weeks. Once the snow had melted, I remember going to the Odeon for a treat. In this view, we looked towards St Margaret's Banks and the Medway Little Theatre. This is just a glimpse of Rochester High Street. I used to love the High Street and the history. Wonderful memories of the Dickens Festival. There's the old castle. So I've done some works that have been inspired by the High Street. This one is made of balsa wood and oil paint. This one is made of clay, leather and paper. The figures are made of clay. This is a scene from behind the Bull Hotel. I used it in one of my books. These two paintings were inspired in the High Street, with Chertsey Gate on the left and the main High Street on the right. As I was saying earlier, it's Lane's the toy shop. I love doing this painting. That's us all, my sister, brother and I, looking in the window. We're just about to put a penny in the slot. How wonderful those memories are. This is an acrylic painting. It would have taken me maybe 2 or 3 days to paint. So all of the works are done on stretch canvas. So 12-ounce stretch canvas, that's really strong. Then it's primed with 4 coats of paint. That's the train obviously going around in the window there. So yeah, it's primed with 4 coats of paint. And then I get into the actual painting. Lots and lots of glazes. This is the Dole's Hospital that I was talking about earlier. Had a wonderful smell, that shop. It was like, must have been built early Victorian days or maybe even sooner. It smelled of like wood and beeswax. It was amazing. Dark though. And I didn't like all the dolls' heads. To me it was like a ghosty sort of place. There was arms and legs in the drawers and everything and cupboards. And to me they looked like skulls and things. I found it very, very creepy. But the dolls' eyes had broken and they needed fixing. That's the lady behind the counter. It looks somewhat like my mum. I used her as a model for that.
The next part of our journey is walking to Upna via Frindsbury and Whitewall Creek. How we used to love going for that walk. We would walk up our road and pass the Sandsprell pub and just go a little way up Frindsbury Hill and take a turning to the left. So I think I've rambled enough now. I'll let you enjoy this next bit of the film. I'll be talking for ages if you let me go. Okay, well, enjoy.
Walking to Upna via Frindsbury and Whitewall Creek. Once again, we would leave home, this time with our fishing nets in hand. We would pass by Frittenden Road and look across to the Chatham Dockyard. We'd walk halfway up Frindsbury Hill and took a pathway which led past an old quarry, past the open farmland and the old tithe barn. We went across a potato field and on to Whitewall Creek. Here in this photo you can see the position of the next painting. The yellow lines on the map show a main road and the entrance to a massive tunnel which goes under the River Medway. Here we used to catch lizards, butterflies and tadpoles in the little ponds. The whole area was tranquil with abundant wildlife. We rarely saw another soul. Sometimes I would sleep at one of the houseboats moored here. I had a friend, Annette McCrum. In this map you can see as it is today, that's the position of the painting. Rats used to scurry all over these boats. We would find hidden treasures amongst the mud. That is Chatham Dockyard on the left-hand side of the painting. This map shows the location of the painting. My sister, brother and I, and our little dog. Leaving Whitewall Creek behind us, we would now continue our journey towards Upper Upna and Upna Castle. A muddy pathway took us alongside the sandy cliffs. This painting of 1968 shows Chatham Dockyard and its nuclear crane, which then dominated the skyline. As a young child, we loved to play in Upna Castle, which was very close by. We hid in the gunpowder tunnels and played on the spiral staircase. In those days, the castle was run down and the wooden flooring was precarious. I've included an earlier painting looking from the dockyard towards the castle. On we walked up a little high street and down a huge flight of steps. Patman's wharf and boat storage would come into view. I understand that the yard has been there since around 1946, having been relocated from Woolwich, I believe. The huge crane in the painting was installed around 1964. That's me with my sister and brother. This is the sweet shop at Lower Upna, or at least that is what we called it. Rarely did we ever buy anything though. The shop was just a stone throw from the river's edge. The phone box was an interesting place too. It was smelly, and on the walls above the phone were small cards which showed ladies' legs and phone numbers. How strange, I thought. The Seaside Shelter, Upna, 1959. I was always so pleased to having reached the shelter. Time to sit and rest and eat my apple. I would sit and look at the massive training ship that was moored close by. I was sad to see it demolished in the 1960s. This is the view from the shelter. Here on the beach, we are searching for treasure. We once found some old clay pipes and a coin. Behind us is the Arethusa training ship, built in the 1800s. It left Upna in March 1975. Some happy memories there. That's some of the clay pipes. They date back to the 1600s. In the distance is the Arethusa training ship. The Dorothy. In the late 1950s, we used to see an old wreck which had been washed up on the beach. I think it was called the Dorothy, a houseboat with tea rooms. It was later washed away in a storm in the early 1960s and never to be seen again. Albion Terrace. Directly opposite the Arethusa training ship was Albion Terrace, or Row, as some people called it. I remember how old and run down the houses looked. I was actually frightened of them and believed that witches and goblins lived inside. They were demolished in the 1960s. That's the scene of as it was today. This map shows the location of the paintings at Upnor.
So now we leave Upnor behind us and we start our journey home. We'd walked all that way. Sometimes we were out for 3 or 4 hours or more. So on the way home one day, we walked past the cricket club at Upnor. And there's like a little junction in the road there where the little river goes under the road. And this is where I found this cannonball, my sister and brother and I. We found this cannonball. It was actually under the road, in like a culvert under there. So we carried it all the way home. I'll weigh it in a little while and see how much it weighs and put it in at the end of the film. So this massive, huge cannonball, I was only probably about maybe 7 years old, and we had to carry it from where we found it. It would normally take us about 25 minutes to walk from that point to home, but we had this massive cannonball to carry between the three of us. So step by step we'd walk and carry the cannonball. We'd only walk like 10 steps each. Then we put it down, and then the next person would pick it up, and we'd walk another 10 steps or more, and so on and so forth. Must have taken us about 2 hours to carry the cannonball home. Later on in life, by the age of about 11 or 12, I would ride in this area. There was a horse riding place out at Cliff, owned by a man called Mr. Finch. So we would ride the ponies all the way from Cliff Woods, all the way to Wainscott, to Upnor, and along the beach somewhere, sometimes halfway to Hoo. How wonderful it was. So this leg of my journey is walking from home to Wainscott School and Wainscott in general. It was really a quiet little village back in the day. Actually, we were one of the first people to move in our home. I actually remember them laying the pavements. There was a man there with the builders and he had a lovely white dog. But anyway, that's diverting a little bit. So in this part of the film, I'll be showing you what the views were like when we used to walk to Wainscott. And I will talk all about the little grocery shop, or should I say greengrocers, that my mum would call Mrs. Randall's. And then I would walk on, we'd walk on to Wainscott School, and there's all the paintings of my memories of the school. My sister Lynn has helped me with these memories too. I've actually sat with her and done some sketches and we've correlated notes, and I hope you enjoy the paintings. So here we go then, ready for the next part of the journey.
Walking to Wainscott and Wainscott School. Here is the Tutti Frutti man. Oh, how we love the ice cream man coming round. We didn't often get one though, they were very expensive, couldn't really afford them. That's a picture of my sister and I. Often we would look out the window and wish that we could have one. During our many walks across the countryside, when we took our jam jars with us, I'd fish for pond snails. I'd bring them home, clean them with a toothbrush, and then put them in jam jars full of water and sell them from the garden wall. This was my first business. This is Frittenden Road, the first view of when we started our walk to Wainscott. Down we would walk down Frittenden Road and look across to the strawberry fields. Just a few seconds down the road and was beautiful open farmland. They grew different crops each year, but strawberries were our favourites. I actually went strawberry picking there one day myself when I was 14. Beautiful memories. There's now a freeway going through the strawberry fields. That's a little bit sad, hey? In the village of Wainscott was the greengrocer's shop. My mum used to call it Mrs. Randall's. I called it the boring shop. My God, could my mother talk. She seemed to natter for hours on end and it would drive me completely nuts. That's me with my sister and brother. The houses date back to the 1800s. Inside was just as boring. It was dusty and smelly, smelled of old cabbages, and it was an interesting place, and Mrs. Randall seemed a lovely person, but I hate it. The nattering would go on and on and on, and then we had to walk a quarter of a mile home with all the stuff that we'd bought. That is one of my unhappy memories, Mrs. Randall's. This is a picture of Wainscott. It's just an abstract view. It takes in the many elements that I enjoyed and didn't enjoy as a child. This is Wainscott School. My sister started there in 1957. I used to walk there each day with my brother in the pram. I didn't like school at all. The school's been on that site since the mid-1800s, I believe. That's Mr. Bolton, the lollipop man. That's out of bounds, behind the main school. Was an air raid shelter there, and a big chimney that used to burn rubbish. You weren't allowed to play in that area either. That's me hiding in the air raid shelter. That's me in the painting too. I put myself twice in the one work. So this is an aerial view of the school as it is today, and I've drawn in there where the air raid shelter used to be. Obviously the school has now grown over. That's my sister in the pigsty. Bless her. We got together and spoke for hours, you know, with our memories of Wainscott School, which has had, you know, between the pair of us, we've managed to join all the memories, and this is what the paintings are about. It's wonderful seeing the memories come to life. This is the position of where the pigsty used to be on a modern day map. It's now part of the car park, I think. This is the fish pond. The fish pond was in the out of bounds area out the back of the school, the area that backs onto the old houses on Wainscott Road. It was overgrown with blackberry bushes and bracken and small trees. There was like broken pots and old bits of stone and everything. Here I show the various stages of the acrylic painting of the fish pond. This is a position of where the fish pond used to be, in the middle of waste ground at the top of the field. The school fete. It was the highlight of the year, and the best bit for me was the fancy dress competitions and the pony rides, of course. I've always had a love of horses, and I think that this is where it began. Fishing for ducks was good too. This is me and my friends with the fancy dress costumes. They were happy times, the school fetes. That's my sister fishing. This is an image of aerial view of Wainscott School again, and shows the next painting that's going to come into view. It was all open farmland and cornfields. How things have changed. This is the area of the cornfields that I was speaking about. That's looking to the school. Behind the school huts behind the main road, so they were built in the 1940s, I believe. There was a path that used to go past the huts all the way across the Wainscott fields. Could walk for ages. It was wonderful. It was full of wildlife. There's a map now looking down on the school as it used to be, all playing fields and allotments. The world is changing, that's for sure. Happy memories walking across the Wainscott path, and riding too. Here we can see the layout of the pigsty, fish pond, the air raid shelter, the chimney and the cornfields. When I left Wainscott School, I had my photo taken along with the rest of the class. I think this was taken in 1966. I also went round everyone and got people to sign my autograph book. So that's Mrs. Walker. She was my first teacher when I was 5 years old. She signed that for me. Mrs. Mainprize, she was one of my favourite teachers. That's her signature on the left-hand side there. I also got a number of my school friends to sign my autograph book. A lot of fun that was. I didn't expect to be looking at this half a century later and making a little film.
So in 1980, there was a fire at Wainscott School. It happened one Saturday night. So the next part of the film is a little video that I created of the school fire.
The fire began early on Saturday morning and quickly took hold. According to the local newspapers, it was probably started deliberately. The fire badly damaged one wing of the school and most of the school records were lost. The school was built in the 1870s and largely constructed of brick with a wooden lining and a slate roof. The whole wing was demolished and temporary classrooms were brought in. The school has now been expanded onto what was the old playing field, and the remains of the old building is now a childcare facility.
So we're coming towards the end of the film now, but there's still a few bits to go. So I used to love Slough Fort, All Hallows. When I went there, it was actually a riding school. So the next little section is about the riding school. And also there's one of Gillingham. I used to have a costume studio there. It was called Paraphernalia. I had the studio for about 10 years and altogether I designed maybe almost 1,000 costumes. Many of you may have come there and hired the costumes from me. It was right by the Medway Hospital, on the corner there, near Upper Manor School.
So here we are at Slough Fort. Slough Fort is out at All Hallows. The fort was built in 1867. When I used to go there, it was used as a riding school. I had a lot of fun there. Used to take the horses out along the sea wall. Sometimes we would groom them. Sometimes we would lead other people's horses. That's me patting a little Palomino horse there. Some wonderful memories of my times with horses. This painting has been completed using acrylic paints on stretch canvas. That's me with my sister grooming. Again with my sister. What fun we had. These are all acrylic paintings. So this is the final painting in the series, my Paraphernalia costume studio, which was in Gillingham, in York Avenue. I operated the costume business from there between 1982 and 1988. Well, I do hope you've enjoyed this film, everyone, and look out for my next film, which is coming out soon. Thank you, everyone, for watching.